good to be back tonight, and another precious day of life the Lord's given us. Thankful for that. Y'all keep Miss Cynthia, she's back at Hopeview Rest Home. Keep her in your prayers, her and Brother Wayne. Also, Miss Oliver, keep her in your prayers. I think she's going to be going to Hopeview Rest Home. Keep her in your prayers. Also, keep Chris and Bobby. Bobby was having a blood transfusion midweek last week, so keep them in your prayers. Different ones that sick here in church. Brother J.D., you lead us in prayer tonight. I was listening to the rain. It's still dry. You go out in the pasture, it's still real dry. So maybe the Lord will keep on sending some and get caught back up. Page number 180. In the red book.
When we're up on the mountain. The notice included the number to dial, and when people called, she would ask, "What hymn would you like to hear?" And within a few months, her playing had brought cheer to several hundred people, and many of them freely poured out their hearts to her, and she was able to help and to encourage them. And so that's what ministry is all about, is just reaching out and touching somebody's life. And we're going to look at a story of how that plays out tonight. Look with me, if you will, in Luke chapter 10, and we're going to begin reading in verse number 38. It says, "Now it came to pass that as they went, that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving, and came to him and said, 'Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore to help me.' And Jesus answered and said unto her, 'Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things. But one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her.'" Let's pray together tonight. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you how that you allow us to just examine your word, and we can dissect it, and we can dive into it, and you just allow it to come alive to us. And Lord, that we can make practical application of your word into our daily lives. So Lord, I pray tonight that if we look at a portrait of ministry, that you would just open our eyes and our hearts and begin to see some things that we could do just to do ministry for those that we come in contact with. So Lord, I pray that you would just guide us and direct us, help us to just do the things that you want us to do, and may you be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. If we are to paint a portrait of ministry with our lives, it must be done in the right spirit. And so what are some ingredients that one must possess in order to have the right spirit in ministry? And I want to just kind of break this down tonight in three different sections. This passage gives us some of those things. One is that we need to see and understand the foundation of ministry. Anything that we're going to do is just like building this building. Is that even though it is on a concrete slab, there had to be some sort of foundation preparation. There had to be some things done in order to get it ready to pour the concrete pad, so that when the building came up and it was constructed, that it would support the foundation, would support the building. And so anything that we do in the way of ministry, we have to make sure that it is on a sure foundation. We have to make sure the foundation is right before we do anything else. But notice what it says in verse 38 and 39. It says that it came to pass that as they went, that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house, and she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. Now, I want you to understand that if we're going to make sure about this foundation of ministry, we must make sure that we have a connection to Jesus. And we talked about that this morning, that if we're going to have that connection to Jesus, we have to have a personal relationship with Him. If we're going to minister in Jesus' name, then we have to have a relationship with Him in order to do that. And so the way that we have that personal relationship with Him is that, as we said this morning, you just admit that you were a sinner. You believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins. You confess your sin, commit your life to Him, and God says that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you enter into that personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and that opens the door for us to be able to begin a foundational ministry with our lives. I think that there are some things that we have to think about in this foundation of ministry. I think that there has to be a sensitivity to ministry. I think that we have to be open to that. And when I retired from Heritage Point 18 months ago, Kathy and I talked about it on numerous occasions, about the fact that we wanted God to open doors of ministry for us, because we were not doing that every day. I had been a pastor, and I was involved and engaged with the membership of the church, and there was always somebody that was sick. There was always a shut-in that needed to be finished. There was family was having a crisis over here, another family having a crisis over there, and so there was always some point of ministry. But when we just bowed out of that altogether and I retired, we weren't sure that God would open those doors of opportunity, and so we asked Him to do that. We asked Him to open those doors of ministry, and it has been phenomenal what God has done, about how that He has opened doors of ministry for me to be able to minister, for Kathy to be able to minister. God just, we get home in the afternoon and we're talking about things that God does that is an open door of opportunity for us. Just a sensitivity to that ministry. Last year, the end of 2022, I had a little electrical issue, and I went to a friend of mine that I knew. He's an electrical engineer, and I knew he could help me fix what that problem was on this item that I had. And I went by to see him, and we went out in his little shop, and he began to work, and he worked, and he got my problem solved. And so we're just sitting there visiting and talking, and he just looked up and he said, "Preacher," he said, I've been reading the New Testament. And I said, "Fantastic." And this guy was raised in a good Christian home, but when he graduated from high school, he went in the military, and then he went to college, and then he was working, and so he did not, and he admits, he said, "I did not raise my family going to church, and I'm sorry for that, man." But anyway, he just mentioned that, and he said, "But you know," he said, "I read this stuff," and he said, "I have a lot of questions." And he was just like, God was just kind of hitting me with a taser and saying, you know. And so I said, "Hey, would you be interested in coming?" I said, I do a little men's Bible study on Tuesday morning. Would you be interested in coming to that?" And he said, "Well, I might." He said, "You know, I might not make it every week, but I'll try." And so the next Tuesday, this was like on Friday, the next Tuesday he didn't come. But the next Tuesday he came, and I can count on one hand and have fingers left over the time he missed that Bible study. But it was just a fact of being sensitive to say, "Would you come? Would you want to be involved in this?" And so he is growing by leaps and bounds in his Christian walk just because he's connecting with those men every week. And he will tell you, "Hey, I look forward to coming on Tuesday morning to our Bible study time." And so we have to have a sensitivity to that that ministry mindset. But also, we have to seek out those ministries. We have to be open for that. We have to put our radar out. We have to put the antenna up. We have to be looking for those opportunities. Because I'm going to tell you something, folks. I kind of get tunnel vision sometimes. And I've got 9 things that I need to do today, and it's already lunchtime, and I've only got one of those things done, and I'm pushing to get through those 9 things done, and I'm trying to get it all taken care of, and sometimes I lose that sensitivity, and I don't seek those opportunities for ministry. I just walk out. And I think all of us do. I think all of us just kind of walk on by those opportunities. But I think that what we have to do is if we're going to have a foundation of ministry in our life, we're going to have to just make ourselves available and be open to those ministry opportunities that come our way. And it may just be speaking to somebody. It may be sharing a smile with somebody. It may be sharing an encouraging word with somebody. It may not be something that costs you money and cost you a lot of time to do that. And so we have to think about how that plays out. But I think the foundation of ministry, when we are sensitive to it and we seek it, I believe that it is satisfying to us. Notice what it says here in the scripture. It says that Martha invited Jesus into their house. And then it talks about Mary, and it says, Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. There was a satisfying element in that. And so, when we are engaged in ministry, there's a satisfaction that comes with that. That people, we know that we can walk away from that situation and say, I helped them. I hope I gave them something that they can take me on today. And that's one of the reasons, even though I started doing it like yesterday with the Greek class, I started doing that before I retired. But now, to do that, I walk away from that and say, I hope that we help somebody today. I hope that we offer them some kind of help in the midst of their grief. And when I do some of the things that I do in chaplaincy, I hope that I walk away and that I've made an impact on somebody's life. And so it's that idea of it's satisfying to us. Matter of fact, I went on a chaplain call one night this week. And they called me on Tuesday night, and I went, and this lady that was in the neighbor's house and everything, and her boyfriend had died, and I walked in the house, and she looked at me. I didn't recognize her, but she looked at me, and she said, "You're the chaplain, aren't you?" Before I ever said a word, she said, "You're the chaplain, aren't you?" And I said, "Yes, ma'am." I said, "How did you know?" And early last year, they had a neighbor that was involved in a very tragic accident and died. And she and this boyfriend happened to be there when it happened. And they called me to come, and I ministered to her when her neighbor died. And so when I walked in when her boyfriend died, she recognized it all of us. And I want you to know, it's nothing about Neal Brown, but it just opened that door of opportunity because she was more open to hear what I had to say because I already had some contact with her. I'd already dealt with her in one tragedy, and now I was helping her through another tragedy. And so God provides those kinds of things. But then sometimes when we get on that ministry boat and we're focused on doing ministry, sometimes that not only is there the foundation of ministry, but sometimes there's a in ministry. Sometimes there's some frustration about it. Notice what it says in verse 40 and 41. It says, "But Martha was cumbered about much serving, and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me. And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things." You see, Martha was so busy serving, she was forgetting the real important thing. And sometimes the old saying is that we get so heavenly minded we're no earthly good. Sometimes we get so busy with busyness we forget about what's important. I had a pastor friend, he's retired now too, and he said that sometimes the urgent overtakes the important. And that's what had happened here, is that Jesus had come to town, his disciples were with him, and Martha was worried about fixing food. She was worried about making sure they had lunch. But Mary was concerned about sitting at Jesus' feet and absorbing everything that he had for her. Sometimes we get frustrated by that. Sometimes I was sharing with someone not long ago, they had a situation and I didn't think they had handled it like it should have been handled, and I was telling them, I said, but you know, sometimes it's like when you counsel with people. I have counseled with people over the years, and I said, you know, I think if you would try this, this, and this, you can make that situation better. And they get up and walk out of my office, and instead of doing A, B, and C, they do X, Y, and Z. And their life falls apart. And then they come back to me and they're like, and what I want to say is, I told you to do A, B, and C, but you did X, Y, and Z. But I was telling this individual, I said, sometimes you have to love people through that. And that's what Jesus was doing. Hey, Martha, you're too worried about getting lunch on the table. And we'll eat when the time comes. But, you know, Mary, she's over here sitting at my feet. She's soaking up what I've got for y'all. And so sometimes as you involve yourself in ministry, my suggestion would be, don't get so caught up in doing the ministry that you forget about Jesus. Because that's who it's all about. That's who we're trying to, that's who we're trying to get people, that's where we're trying to point them, is point them to Jesus through the ministry. Through the ministry. There was a preacher asked a certain man why he had stopped attending church services. The man replied, "They haven't treated me right over there." And the preacher said, "Well then, why don't you go home and beat your wife?" And the backslider said, "My wife hasn't done anything against me." And the preacher said, "Well, has the Lord Jesus done anything against you?" And so the point was, is sometimes being peeved at the brethren forsaking the Lord is about as logical as being angry with the dog and kicking the cat. We have to keep our perspective in this. See, Martha's critical spirit, if you call it that, was found even though she was in the very presence of the Lord, and that same critical spirit can be found in our churches today. I had a lady one time years ago after we moved up here. God was just pouring his blessing out on our church. And we had people who were joining the church. People were being saved. It was a wonderful experience. And one day this lady looked at me and she said, "I'm not sure we need those kind in our church." And I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "You know what? We just don't need those kind in our church." And I knew what she meant because I knew who she was talking about. They weren't on the socioeconomic rung of the ladder where she was. And she said, we'll meet them in our church. But I will tell you that that specific family that she was talking about, they stuck with us, and they were a vital part of our ministry there. And the mom and daughter died. The mom died in October of 21, and the daughter died in February of 22 from COVID. And so our church took a big blow from those kind of people. Amen. Because they've been there a long time. As a matter of fact, Kathy was telling me just the other day that the daughter's son came to the beauty shop to get his haircut the other day. And Kathy babysat him when they came. Kathy babysat him in the nursery. She kept him in the nursery. He was a year old. And now he has grown. He's this big old robust man and has a family of his own. And, you know, it's amazing to see that. But sometimes people get their eyes off of what's important. And meeting needs in people's life is what is important. That's the whole gist of it, is how can I meet a need for God's life? So let's finish this out with talking about the foundation of ministry and the futility in ministry, but let's look at the fullness of ministry. Notice what it says in verse 42. Jesus says, but one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her. Mary has chosen the good part. You see, I don't think that we can effectively do ministry if we're trying to do it outside the realm of sharing Jesus. Now, I will tell you that when I put my chaplain hat on, I leave my Baptist hat in the car. Now, some people may not understand this, but I hope you'll get what I'm saying. Because I'm not there as a Baptist, I'm not even there as a preacher. I'm there as a minister. And I leave that in the car, and I'm there just to minister to those people. And I don't always have an opportunity. It does not always avail itself for me to share the ABCs of salvation. And sometimes to share the ABCs of salvation in that situation is not appropriate. But when Papaw has died, and Mamaw is broken, and I just come and I sit down next to her and I take her by the hand and I begin to talk to her. And I begin to ask her, tell me how long y'all been married. Tell me what y'all did for a living. Tell me how many children you have. And I begin to ask her those questions. And I begin to get Mama to talk. And I begin to calm her down. And I begin to get her to focus on something else. And then I look at her and I say, can I have prayer with you? That's the fullness of ministry. That's what it's all about, is being able to come in and touch and impact people's lives. And just like that lady said the other night, you're the chaplain. I've had people I've had people to walk up to me at the post office. I've had people walk up to me at Walmart, and I would not remember them. But they would say, hey, you were there when such and such happened. And so it made an impact. And that's all I want to do is I want to leave Jesus with them. I want to leave Jesus with them so that they know that He is important, and He is above everything else in our lives. Let me close with a story. I don't think I have shared this story since I've been here, but I want to share this story. When we were in Harrison County, we had a family that we just grew to love and appreciate. There were three generations of that family in the church and all, but the older couple, when they came to church, they sat back there about where Keith and Daniel are sitting on this side from the pulpit. They were sitting there. And I'd go by and I would speak to Miss Ruth. And sometimes she would even acknowledge me except for Miss Ruth was quiet. She was almost backwards. She was not going to sing in the choir. She was not going to teach a Sunday school class. She barely speak to me. But Miss Ruth had a vibrant She's kind of like the lady that played the piano. But Miss Ruth was some more cooker. And if somebody was having surgery, if somebody lost a family member to death, if somebody was just, if they had the flu, and they were down for a few days, Miss Ruth got out her grocery list. Paul, I need you to go to the grocery store. And Mr. Paul would go to the grocery store and he'd buy those things and come back, and Miss Ruth would spend all day teaching, getting all that stuff ready. And when she got it ready, she'd say, Paul, why don't you take this to so-and-so? And Mr. Paul would get in the car and he would deliver it. Matter of fact, while we were there, Daddy had some surgery, and she cooked the meal for us, and Mr. Paul brought it to our back door one day. And there is no telling how many people, how many lives that Ruth Rock has touched. She never said a word to them verbally, but she said a lot to them when she cooked that meal. And she sent that meal that she prepared with her own hands. And she said, I want you to have this. I want to minister to you this way. And that's what she did. That was her ministry. And she did it over and over and over again for people in the community. They didn't even have to live in my church. She just did that because God had put that in her heart. She wouldn't go and speak. She wouldn't go and talk. But she was going to cook. And she would cook. And she would cook out those little He made an impact on people's lives. So my encouragement to you tonight is this. Number one, if you're here tonight and you don't have that personal relationship with Jesus Christ, we're going to pray in just a minute, and we're going to give you an opportunity that maybe that's a prayer that you would want to pray tonight. That you want to pray and say, hey, I need to invite Jesus. I need to give my life over to Him, and we'd love for you to do that. But then you say, I know I'm a believer, Pastor Neal. I know I'm a believer. But you know, I really just, I don't know. I kind of flounder in that area of ministry. And I want to encourage you. We're going to pray in just a minute, and I'm going to give you that opportunity just to ask God, just open my eyes, open my heart, open the door for ministry. And I will tell you, if you don't want to minister, don't do that, because Kathy and I prayed, he's knocked the door down. You know, I mean, sometimes it's like drinking from a fire hose. So if you're not interested, don't pray that prayer. But if you are, I only encourage you to pray that prayer. And if you're already involved in a ministry, you've already got something that God's laid on your heart, and you're doing that, and God's honoring that, I just want you to pray tonight for God to enhance that, for God to expand that, for God to deepen that, and make you so aware that He's at work in your life in that area of ministry. Because this is what I'm a firm believer in, is that in the 1950s, you could build a building, put a steeple on top, open the doors on Sunday, and people would flock to the church house. Because we didn't have a lot of other things to do. But now, society and culture has changed. Everything is different now. And so, we may not be able just to open the doors and turn the lights on and say, y'all come. We're going to have to get our hands dirty in the fields, out there, touching lives, getting messy with those people in order to get them in here. And I believe that this church will begin to do that. Because no, there's not another church close by down here. So you've got a wide open field to touch these people in Waterville community. And so to come up with those ministries where that you can begin to touch those lives. But if you're already involved, just ask God to help you do that. And then as a church, pray that God will keep you ministering that would open the doors for people to come. Because I believe when you show people that you care, they'll come. Let's pray, okay? I want you just to pray tonight, and if you're already a believer, I want you to pray that if there's somebody here tonight that needs to know Jesus, that they'll do that. And for somebody maybe that is here and they need to be saved tonight, they need to become a believer, I'm going to just lead you in a little prayer. And just get you to pray this prayer with me or something simple. Just to say, dear God, I know that I'm a sinner. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sin. I confess my sin to you. I apologize for it. I want you to come into my life. I want to have a personal relationship with you. And I want to live with the promise of going to heaven when I die. And I commit my life to you. In Jesus' name. Now every head is bowed, every eye is closed. Nobody's looking at me. If you pray that prayer tonight, would you just lift your hand up? To spend some time to try to preach while praying. And if you've been reluctant to get involved in ministry of some kind, you really don't have a personal ministry, you're not really engaged in some of the church ministry, I would encourage you just to, right now, just to pray. Say, God, would you open that door off? Spend some time asking God to open that door opportunity for you.
you already have a ministry. If you'd like God to deepen that ministry in your life, would you just pray right now and say, God, you know, I'm doing this, this, and this, but I want you to deepen that. I want you to explain that in whatever way you choose to do that. So, can you pray that right now? You may not know what that is, and that's okay. But just ask God to reveal to you as a group of people, reveal to you as a church, what are some ministries that y'all can be involved in that would be very practical, very life-changing for people in this community? Pray that way. Father, I'm awed by the fact that when we ask, you answer. When we ask for you to open doors of opportunity of ministry for us, you open those doors of opportunity. Lord, I'm thankful for it. So, Lord, I just pray tonight for Waterville Baptist Church as they think about individually and collectively how they can do ministry in this community. That it would impact the lives of so many people in this community that we would just see you do some amazing things through these people being the hands and feet of Jesus. Father, I pray tonight that if there's somebody here that maybe they prayed that prayer and were reluctant to raise their hand, or maybe they're considering praying that prayer for salvation, that you would just guide them and lead them to that moment where they would pray that prayer and then surrender their life. Lord, I want to pray for this church tonight. I want to pray for the search committee. As they continue to work, as they continue to seek out that prospective pastor. Lord, I pray that you would just raise that man up in order that it would be very evident to the search community. It would be just evident to the church. Yes, this is the man. This is the man that needs to be our pastor. Lord, I pray that then you would bring the church through the committee together with that prospective pastor. Lord, that you would knit their hearts together in a bond much like David and Jonathan had, and then they can move forward and doing the work in this community, growing the kingdom, reaching people, sharing the gospel. So, Lord, I pray that you would just, you would bring that about in your timing, because we know your timing is coming. Father, we just ask that you would bring back the past. Father, thank you for the opportunity that Kathy and I have just to be here with them, just to love on them, to try to promote unity and love, Lord, that you would guide and direct us as we do. So, Father, we pray that as we go to our homes tonight, that you keep us safe. Thank you that you love us, that you care for us. Lord, I pray we'll come back Wednesday night excited about what you want to speak to us from your word. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right, before you leave, thank you for being here. And you got anything else, Keith?
A short conference.
Okay, all right. Well, y'all do that. But before you leave, after conference, you got to shake hands for three people before you go. Okay? All right. I'll turn it over to Brother Keith.